very funny. Funny. Yeah. Funny.
Another day in paradise.
Alright, let's do this. I've procrastinated long enough. Wife's been gone for a few days with some family, and I have no other distractions right now. Let's get this script and get it done.
Alright, let's get this over with. I'm not that tall, so what? Looks like I'm in focus. Alright. Welcome to the Tornado Season Forecast 2022. I've decided to ditch the whole parody thing this year. I know, what a hassle that was. And unfortunately, I've got mostly bad news for storm chasers. It's the second La Nina, and there's also a lot of drought. And unlike typical La Ninas, it doesn't look like the Deep South will be particularly active this year. So I guess let's get into the details, if we must. Here's some maps of the plains for some similar La Nina seasons. Yeah, it's terrible. Below average, chasing won't be great. But hey, at least there's April 2012 to look forward to, maybe. Yeah, well, that was an easy video to make.
What?
With estimated wind speeds up to 190 miles per hour, this tornado...
I thought I'd fix that. Where are you? I thought you were coming home today.
No, that's tomorrow. My flight boards at 10 tonight.
Okay. I just thought... Alright, let's get this uploaded. Where's the file? Where's the video? What the hell?
Welcome to Tornado Season Forecast 2022. Again, I'm not doing the whole parody thing this year. Here's how my previous forecasts went, I guess, and bad news for storm chasers. It's a second La Nina, and oh boy, there's so much drought. But not like other La Ninas, it looks like the Deep South may not be nearly as active as, like, say, last year. Here's some map of the plains, similar Nina seasons. Yeah, it kind of sucks for storm chasing, but hey, at least there's April 2012, I guess. All right. I don't want to do this again. It sucked. Ugh.
Oh. I'm gonna stay up. Wait for this to finish. And then upload it tonight.
Well, for night, but it might have been up. Autobots or Decepticons? What a shitty question to end on. That's interesting. And I never stop.
Where are you? I thought you said you were going to be home last night.
No, I don't even get to the airport until 10.
Son of a... Forget it.
Yes.
That was even a cow. Are you going to be home tonight, or...
Yep, I don't have to be to the airport until 10.
Fantastic. I'm in a time loop cliche. I'm in a time loop cliche. I'm in a time loop cliche.
I guess I might as well make use of the time and learn to play.
Okay, I get it. I need to do this right. It's been months. It's the worst case of SDS ever. Here goes nothing.
Tornado season forecasting is nearly comical, but not completely useless. There are certain background states visible during winter that can help us gauge some of the outcome of a typical spring season, even as far out as maybe the end of May, the typical peak for tornado frequency in the United States. And while it's impossible to predict tornadoes this far out, predicting the background state and conditions favorable for severe weather is somewhat reasonable. I look at two major Pacific Ocean temperature anomaly areas. Sea surface temps in the Pacific can have somewhat predictable impacts to winter in the US and well into mid-spring. The ENSO, where today we are firmly entrenched in a La Niña, or cold phase, off the coast of South America along the equator, and related to it, a typically opposite condition in the North Pacific, where temperatures are running warm. This is considered a negative PDO, and in this case, a particularly strong one. The other factor I like to look at is the prevalence of drought in the southwestern portions of the United States, a near desert-like region that, if drier than normal, can lead to very warm mid-levels over the plains of the U.S., creating a cap that can suppress storms, or more technically called the EML, or elevated mixed layer. A weaker EML, typically caused by cool and wet conditions throughout winter in this region, can result in storms in the plains firing up too early in the day to be effective at producing tornadoes. Or a more middling EML can lead to something we call a loaded gun, unstable atmosphere, where storms fire up late in the afternoon during peak daytime heating. Or a strong EML caused by hot and very dry conditions in this area, which will prevent storms from firing up at all. If the EML is strong, however, storm systems further downstream might be even more potent, leaving the southeastern U.S. even more vulnerable than usual to powerful severe weather, and of course, more tornadoes. Neutral ENSO favors tornado activity on the plains, while La Niña generally favors more tornadoes in the deep south of the U.S. My methodology is to then look at years with similar ENSO background states and compare drought data to previous years. Then I can look at other teleconnections like Arctic Oscillation and PDO and narrow down these analogous years. Finally, I compare and contrast the outcomes of these seasons to historic tornado data, with a heavy preference on more recent years, which should have a similar climate. This year, however, I can dig deeper than ever before. With our new Tornado Archive database online, I can look at tornado seasons going back long before 1950. And with Brett's website comparing storm-chasing conditions from year to year, I have a clearer picture than ever on what we can expect with tornado season 2022, where above or below average conditions for tornadoes might be, what storm chaser sentiment might be, and even whether we might end the year above or below average overall. So let's talk 2022. We have a moderate La Niña in place as of mid-January, and it's a second La Niña that, for whatever reason, seems to matter when it comes to historical tornado outcomes. Drought conditions in Texas, Colorado, and New Mexico are fairly severe, and not a whole lot of improvement is expected in the near term like we had last year. This alone would lead me to expect that the plains might become too capped pretty early in the season for any frequent or major tornado events. Specifically, I would suggest early May and onward might be especially quiet. La Niña, however, would normally suggest a more active season in the deep south. But again, second La Niña years aren't typically on the higher end, like first-year La Niñas. Once again, our next step is to look at those handy analogs, other spring tornado seasons that had similar background conditions this time in winter. While far from perfect, knowing where we are now can sort of suggest what patterns we might see in the coming months. So let's take all other moderate La Niña years, but then also weed out any that had way different temperature anomalies in the North Pacific. That leaves us with the following. However, our negative PDO is really negative, so let's focus on other years that did that. One observation is that some of the more significant first-year Niñas automatically drop from favor with this change. As mentioned, second La Niña springs tend to be quite a bit different from first ones anyway, and I would have probably eliminated them regardless. So let's do that. Perhaps it's the very warm negative PDO that is the root cause to low-performing springs. That leaves us with 1972, 76, 89, 2000, 2009, and 2012. 1976 was a third La Niña, and 1989 was a first, while the rest are all second La Niñas, just like we are heading into right now. But two stand out for me in particular, 1972 and 2009. Both feature tornado outbreaks in the December prior, and perhaps even more intriguing about 72 is that 2021 mirrored 1971 so well. Regardless, all of the seasons I've listed are actually pretty similar. In past tornado forecast videos, I've ended up with several different years, but with sometimes competing tornado tendencies. Unfortunately for storm chasers, by similar, most were very low performance for tornado activity on the plains. For the Deep South, even there aren't as many major nor high-end tornado counts there like we would see with other first-year La Niñas. A second La Niña, bad drought in the West, the most likely outcome is below average tornado counts almost across the board. For storm chasers, pay attention to early setups, especially in April. Summer might provide some great chasing opportunities, like 2009 and 1972. Similar things happened in 2000 and 2012. Look out for a handful of interesting things happening in upslope regions and the upper Midwest over the summer to make up a bit for what might be a slow May, if that's what happens to shake loose. For the late winter in the Deep South, overall activity should be average or even on the low side. But don't get your guard down just yet. December 2021 should be a reminder that tornadoes have and will occur during the winter months and early spring. And while personally I don't think it'll be a memorable year overall, it only takes one bad tornado to unleash tragedy onto many people. For the Midwest region of the United States, it's difficult to pin down when things are likely to go ham up there in a given year, but again, I'm expecting a slow spring season and maybe a more average summer. Hopefully not a scorcher mega drought like 2012. So with all that said, 2022 looks like a slow year for tornadoes. Of my analogs, total tornado counts landed between 900 and 1100. For 2022, I'm going to take the weighted mean of that and call it 1000 on the year, quite below average. For chasing this year, I'll try to make lemonade from lemons. Chase early and often, probably be a little pickier in May, especially if it looks like capping might be the main concern. And also keep an eye out for any funny business between the Black Hills down to eastern Colorado over the summer. Well, let's hope that's good enough. I can't wait to get back to real life. Have a safe and fun 2022. Like, subscribe, comment, follow me on Twitter. Hop into my Discord and let me know your thoughts. Or maybe if you have a forecast of your own you'd like to share. Or just stop by and say hello. Until the next video. I'll see you out there.